the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glory splendor of your kingdom. The kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all his ways and kind in all his doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. The word of the Lord. For this reason, I bow down my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with the power of through the Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we all can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Say about this story, that hasn't already been said before. What more could possibly be said about this passage? What more can be drawn out? Well, I'm not going to try and reinvent the wheel today. And in fact, when I was thinking about this passage, I began to think about not something different that I could say, but something different that we could do. And by now, I've been here almost a full year. You know that I like to get you guys involved in a sermon. Some of you are smiling like, oh gosh, I should have stayed another week at the lake. Well, I have some good news for you. We are not going to be so active during the sermon. We're not even going to be so active during the service. In fact, what I'm going to ask you to be active in takes place after the service. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have the ushers come forward, and the ushers are going to pass down baskets down the pews. And in these baskets, you'll notice that there are these little sandwich bags filled with 5 vanilla wafers and 2 Swedish fish. They can be Norwegian fish if you like, but they're Swedish fish. So you'll notice that inside this bag, there's also a little note that says, "Our God provides." You're probably wondering what your task is, your task following the service, your homework, if you will. Oh gosh, Brian's given us homework today at church. Your task is to give this to someone. Seems pretty simple, right? Your task is to give this to someone. Somebody who is not sitting next to you right now, somebody who is not in your family. It might be somebody who's not even here today, but your task is to give this to someone as a reminder that our God provides for all. And not only does our God provides abundantly with more than we need. It's a reminder also that God calls us to live abundantly, to embrace the abundance that God gives to us. Now, but what about all of the people who don't have enough food, who don't have enough clothes, who don't have a place to stay or a place to live? How does God provide for those people? It seems that they don't even have their basic needs met. How is God providing for them? When we talk about God providing in abundance, God providing abundantly, it seems to conflict with what we see in the world, what we see on the news on a daily basis, that there are those who are not living abundantly, who do not have their basic needs met. So we ask, does God really provide? Does God really provide abundantly? Absolutely. Absolutely, God provides abundantly. We tend to remember that Jesus fed 5,000 people with just 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And this is a miracle in and of itself. But we often leave out, in this familiar story, we often leave out the leftovers. Some of us don't really like leftovers. Some of us love leftovers. But we tend to forget the leftovers in this story. There are 12 baskets full of leftovers. So even after taking 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish and feeding 5,000 people, a group roughly 3 times the size of our Dawson community, there are still 12 baskets full of leftovers. God provides abundance. God has always provided abundantly. God comes to childless Abraham, even in his old age, and says, "You will have descendants as numerous as the stars." God provides abundantly. When the Israelites are wandering around the deserts, they come to Moses and complain that we don't have anything to eat. And God provides manna from the sky. Each and every day, God provides abundantly. God provides the Israelites a land flowing with milk and honey, a land that is bountiful. And when we, stuck in our sin, held under the law, expected to somehow save ourselves, knowing that we cannot do it, God provides abundantly. God provides forgiveness and mercy. God provides His only Son. God has always provided abundantly. But we still are left with this question about what about the people who do not have enough to eat? What about those who are hungry and thirsty and homeless and without clothing? How does God provide abundantly for them? Well, many of you have heard about this before, but I want to show you a picture. It's a picture of dirt cakes or mud cakes. These are little cakes, little discs that are made of dirt and mud. And what you do is you take some dirt, you mix it with some water, maybe a little oil if you have it, and you flatten it out. You let it sit outside in the sun while it gets hard and bakes in the sun, like a pancake almost. And then what you do is you eat it. You eat it not because it has any nutritional value, not because it's actually good for you. You eat it because the hunger pangs that you have are so painful that simply even tricking your stomach that it's full is better than not. This is what many people do. Many people in Central America, countries like Haiti, the Dominican Republic, Nicaragua, this is the reality for many people, that they do not have enough food, and so they make these mud cakes to satisfy the hunger pains. I want to show you another picture. This next picture is food waste. This happens to be a picture from Cedar Rapids. This is the food waste. This is food that has been tossed and left to decompose, food that has gone bad. Some of it hasn't gone bad, but it's not wanted, and so it is tossed out. We throw out an average of 70 billion pounds of food a year. That's a lot of food. So when we ask the question, does God provide abundantly, maybe instead of pointing the finger at God and saying, why do you not provide abundantly for these people, maybe it's a question for us. How have we not lived into the abundance that God has provided? How have we maybe fallen short in the ways that we share in the abundance that God has provided to us? If you're like me, the answer to that question doesn't really sit well. It doesn't make me feel very good. It makes me feel very uncomfortable because this question, I know the answer to it. Deep down, I know the answer, and I know that I have thrown out food that was still good. I have not used what God has given to me to share with those who are in need. I have not lived into the abundance that God has provided to me. Not been a good steward of the things that God has provided. It leaves you feeling guilty. And I don't think that this is where God wants to leave us. I don't think that this is what God calls us to do, simply just feel guilty about it. I think that this story, the feeding of the 5,000 is not meant to be anything that draws up guilt in us. I think this is more than a message about sharing our food, sharing what God has given to us. This isn't just a story about being a good steward. I think the feeding of the 5,000 tells us about the character of God. We spend our whole lives learning and seeking to know who this God is, to know more about God. And in our story today, we remember that God is a God of abundance, even despite how we use that abundance. God continues to provide. Graciously, God gives to us all that we need each day and more. Because that is who God is. Even when we fall short, God provides. God has always provided. In the ELCA, our tagline is God's Word, Our Hands. Notice that it starts with God. It is God's work. It starts with God who graciously provides all that we need, and even more. God continues to work in and through us, showing us new ways to live as faithful stewards. Each day is filled with abundance. Each day, God provides. We're going to sing a hymn, Day by Day. This hymn was written by Carolina Sandell. She wrote this hymn, Day by Day, after witnessing her father drown. This caused her, naturally, it caused her much distress, emotional, psychological. She wrote this hymn as a prayer, as a reminder that no matter what happens, no matter the ways that we may fall short, that God always provides. So you have some bread and some fish. You have a little reminder that God provides abundantly. May we all remember the abundance that God provides us each day, and may we go out into the world sharing in that abundance. Amen.
Thank you. Christ Jesus, and my prayer for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. God's generosity and abundance. We pray that you would enlarge our expectations of both heaven and earth, that we may be more willing to receive and more ready to give. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks this day, O Lord, for welcoming Brooklyn into your family. This day we thank you for caring for the smallest and least in our world. Bless, we pray, Courtney and Colin as they raise her up before you and put upon her and them the fullness of your love, that they all may keep the vows and promises that they have made and so become living symbols of your love for all people. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, help us to care for one another and for your world. Cast out any fear that we might have, any sense of inadequacy, any temptation to despair, and give us the courage, the faith, the discipline, the trust, and the love we need to offer the gifts that we have for your work in this world. We pray today for all who are in need. We pray for those who are sick and who require your tender care. We pray for those who are hungry and who require our outstretched hands, our sharing of what we have. We pray for those who are oppressed and who require our passion and our courage, our sharing. We pray for those who suffer in mind and spirit and in soul, who require our prayer, our faith, our witness, our hope in you. We pray that you would bless all who are in need this day. We remember especially those of our community, Charlie John Prestel, Karen Spencer, Kari Ingebrigtsen, Brad Madsen, Ronnie Erickson, Dorothy Myers, Sarah Walberg Adams, Clarence Engler, Karen Batula Trimpin, Michael and Betty Darrington, Deborah Nall, Jack Clayton, Tom Beals, Lauren Thone, Jen Holstrom, Vicki Swenson, Marion Storleen, and the family of Elytris Narrison. We also remember before you the family of Mavis Simonson. And remember those that even now we are bringing to our hearts and minds as we pray before you. Bless all these by your Spirit, by the testimony and the actions of your church, and by the redemption won for them by Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. And God of abundance and God of generosity, if Christ Jesus can accept simple gifts from a boy, like 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and bless them to feed thousands of hungry people, then please get him to take our lives with whatever we have that is good and use it and use us to help others. And by the way, God, if we start making silly excuses, don't listen to us. We ask all these things through our living and eternal word, Christ Jesus himself, in whose name we pray. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.